and hurriedly getting dressed.
Running from across the street,
just like any other 10-year-old, Rohan's routine was typical. Waking up late, hurriedly getting dressed, and rushing to catch the missing bus.
Running from across the street came his friend Ria, who, catching her breath, boarded the bus. School days were bliss, when transition from pencil to pen
and shorts to trousers was a big deal.
Then we were fascinated as 2 into 2 and 2 plus 2 both equal 4.
The last bell set the ball rolling for the unsaid race, where the window seat of the bus was the finishing line. Switching on your favorite cartoon without changing the uniform was the first thing to do when we returned from school.
And it was not long before that his friends called him out to play.
A loud call from mom was all it took to reluctantly return home.
Though the dinner was served, it was more of blabbering about the entire day to our parents.
For escaping from next day's punishment, we unwillingly completed our homework and went to sleep. A sound sleep with our favorite pillow was the ideal end to an eventful yet an hectic day.
Life was like a serene sleep, the same day in and day out. But then the hormones went haywire and waves of emotion gushed in one after the other. The innocent glow of the face was replaced by greasy skin with pimples popping out.
The amiable voice of the child gave rise to the hoarseness of the angry young man.
The distinction between the two sexes became more pronounced. These baffling bodily changes paved way to fascination and curiosity towards the opposite sex.
There was a constant tug of war between them and their changes, which compelled them either to shut themselves off from the world or vent out all their frustration by whichever means possible. Heated arguments followed that led to a communication gap between them and their parents. And when they tried talking,
देख रही हूँ, आजकल तुम बहुत ज़बान लड़ा रहे हो।
पता नहीं, मुझे खुद कुछ समझ नहीं आ रहा। रिया मुझे और लड़कियों से अलग लगती है और मैं भी बस उसी के बारे में सोचता रहता हूँ।
हाँ, पढ़ाई छोड़ के हर जगह ध्यान है तेरा। ये सब फालतू की चीजें छोड़ और पढ़ाई कर।
माँ, मुझे आजकल स्कूल में सब रोहन के नाम से चिढ़ाते हैं और मुझे भी हर वक्त उसी का ख्याल आता रहता है।
क्या खबरदार उस लड़के से कभी बात की तो।
पर माँ,
बस इसके आगे और कोई बात नहीं होगी।
Disappointed with their parents' reaction, they confided in their friends.
Friends advised them to ignore their parents and to go with the flow.
Unaware of the consequences, their infatuation intensified over the time, and then one day they crossed the line. After some days, Ria realized that she had missed her periods. Confused and disturbed, she confided in Rohan, and they came to know that she was pregnant.
Helpless and fearing the social stigma, they had to rely on unreliable sources for abortion.
But this was not an end to their plight. Over the months, Ria's health deteriorated with heavy intermenstrual bleeding, excruciating pain and malaise.
Noticing her failing health, her parents finally took her to doctor. Doctor revealed that the girl has had an unsafe abortion and this has rendered her infertile for life.
At the same time, filled with guilt and regret, Rohan also landed in the abyss of depression.
Thus, this unfortunate turn of events, coupled with ignorance, ruined their blissful yet simple life.
Seventeen-year-old Neha Krishna is mature well beyond her years.
No.
But adulthood was forced upon her.
Every year, 11.8 million girls in India get pregnant between the tender age of 15 to 19 years. Out of these, 4 million girls give birth.
As far as menstrual hygiene is concerned, only 57.6% women in India use sanitary napkins, a whooping 42.4% opt for unhygienic measures, and 70% of them land up with reproductive tract infections.
Regarding STDs, contrary to the popular belief, genital herpes is the most common sexually transmitted disease in India, accounting for 21.9% cases whereas HIV accounts for a mere 0.56% cases, but it's inevitably fatal.
Named life that still has some unread chapters, some unheard stories, and some to be ridiculed resolutions that now need to be unleashed. Because problems are not to be feared off, but to be embraced with open arms. Because they help us to
redefine, recreate,
and rejuvenate our aura.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls,
we present to you Sex Education, Myths and the Reality.
To begin with, what is sex education? Sex education is defined as a broad program that aims to build a strong foundation for lifelong sexual health by acquiring information, attitudes, values and beliefs about one's identity, relationship and intimacy.
And what is sexual health? Sexual health is a state of physical, emotional, mental and social well-being in relation to sexuality, and not merely the absence of a disease, dysfunction or infirmity.
These were the definitions by NCBI and WHO. Now let's have a look what according to people is sex education.
Sex education बद्दल मतलब सगळं माहिती तर आहे सगळं. बाळ कसला जन्माला येतं किंवा सेक्स कसं असं केलं जातं, एन्जॉयमेंट वगैरे जे पण असतं.
अकॉर्डिंग टू मी सेक्स एज्युकेशन इट्स व्हेरी हेल्पफुल फॉर पीपल हू स्टे इन सबर्ब एरिया.
नाही,
सेक्स एज्युकेशन ऐसा है कि बच्चों को जब टेंथ होती है उनकी क्लास उसी टाइम पे उनको बताना चाहिए इसके बारे में. अगर उनको एजुकेट करोगे आप लड़कियों को, लड़कों को, तो बेटर समझ पाएंगे अपने आप को.
The journey of sex education in India was faced with obstacles right from its inception. NCERT took up an initiative to formally and systematically develop a school-based adolescence education program in 1998-2001.
The program was initiated on a pilot basis in six IPD states: Orissa, Gujarat, MP, Maharashtra, Rajasthan and Kerala.
In 2001-2002, the project was formally launched in the above states with major focus on growing up and sexuality, HIV/AIDS and drug abuse.
However, in 2005, adolescence education was merged with the reproductive and child health care program initiated the same year, while sexual, HIV/AIDS and the drug abuse modules were taken up by NACO and Orissa State AIDS Control Society.
When Ministry of HRD started promoting sex education curriculum in 2007, controversies developed, citing the reasons of it being a Western concept against Indian cultural values, provoking sexual behavior and activity in adolescents, and as a promotional means for increasing the sales of contraceptives. It faced significant socio-cultural and political opposition.
As a result, in the years 2007-2009, majority of the states, including Maharashtra, where the sex education curriculum was implemented, succumbed to the pressure and banned it.
Over the years, attempts were made to reintroduce the concept, but due to lack of proper resources, it never materialized.
Order to expose the dilapidated state of yet-to-be-formulated sex education program, we interviewed the principals of 30 schools affiliated to various boards in Meerut and Sangli. Our findings are as follows.
Surprisingly, 12 out of 30 schools do not provide sex education at any level, stating the following reasons.
Since sex education was banned by the government, no extra efforts were taken.
There is no point in giving sex education to the students these days due to their increasing access to social media.
While some answered, it's still in process of implementation.
While some were ignorant about the topic itself. Let's see the highlights of the sex education program conducted in 18 out of 30 schools that were surveyed.
In One school made it a point to give sex education to boys and girls together. 12 out of 18 schools laid more emphasis on girls' sex education, menstrual hygiene being the center of their discussion.
While all the schools taught about the reproductive organs, only 11 out of 18, excluding government schools, included pubertal changes as part of their sessions. A mere 5 out of 18 schools conducted counseling for parents.
Only 4 schools taught about good touch and bad touch, while 4 of the principal shared incidences where pubertal problems were solved through proper counseling.
Triumphantly, we found out that all the schools affirmed the implementation of sex education on a wide scale with government support, with the majority of them holding an opinion that such a step would lead to massive decrease in teenage pregnancy, sexual crimes, male dominance, malice of gender inequalities that still persist in our society.
Came across Ms. Lakshmi Kumar, director of Orchid International School Pune, who have present her full-fledged sex education model in her school.
Sex education is not about how to have sex. Okay? I think sex education is a big word that encompasses the world of growing up. So we should call it more about life skill education. I think when we give them the space in which children are able to, you know, articulate and question and discuss, they know that if they are in trouble, they will come back to us. They don't have to go to any wrong place for seeking information. People, they don't have really very many places to go to where they can get authentic and a correct and a fair information.
To explore deep into the myths prevalent and the awareness present in the society, we conducted an informal online survey with a sample population of 900 adults, comprising majority, that is 71.25%, in the age group of 18 to 21 years. The survey was filled by 56% of medicos, 41% of non-medicos, and a small chunk of paramedicos.
32.4% of the individuals did not receive sex education at all. Of the remaining 67.6% population, 65.8% received it from schools, while 15.1% approached their peers for the same. According to 44% people, classes were conducted separately for boys and girls.
When asked their opinion, a generous 180 people considered sexually transmitted diseases as the only component of sex education.
A staggering 60.3% people never approached their parents concerning pubertal changes. Of the remaining, 90.5% were satisfied with the answers they got.
A choking 41.6% people knew about all the sexually transmitted disease, while most of them felt depressed, confused, and lonely.
Around one-third of the population confessed of not consulting anybody regarding their doubts, clearly indicating an air of awkwardness surrounding this issue.
A meager 19% population knew about all the diseases transmitted sexually, while a chunk of 13.2% people knew AIDS to be the only sexually transmitted disease.
7.7% of the individuals think condoms to be the sole method of contraceptives, and 27% were unaware that only condoms can prevent STDs.
A meager 19% of the people consider that abortion cannot be done as it is an illegal activity.
An alarming 4% of the population regarded ash leaves and sand as alternatives to sanitary napkins. 5% of the literate population considered women as impure during menses.
24% believe masturbation can ruin sexual experience. 23% of the respondents were confused and do not know whether masturbation is normal or not, while a startling 19% consider masturbation as a form of self-abuse.
In spite of the prevailing discrepancies, an impressive 99% of the population were in favor of implementing sex education.
Apart from our survey and school study, we also visited Sneha, a Mumbai-based NGO, to get a wider picture. They have been working for adolescents in Dharavi and nearby areas.
As a result of our research, we felt that there is a strong need of a centrally implemented program by the government under which a uniform, proper and compulsory format of sex education is adopted across the nation. So here is a device format which has two components, adolescents and parents.
Starting with the adolescent population,
we have created two subdivisions. Our first subdivision is between age group of 11 to 13 years, in which topics to be covered are, first, physical changes during puberty, which includes development of genitals, development of breast, pubic hair, axillary and facial hair, hoarseness of voice, weight dreams, erection. Second, menarche and menstruation, under which girls should be taught about vaginal discharge before menarche, abdominal cramps, backache and proper menstrual hygiene.
Our second subdivision is the age group 13 to 15 years, and the topics which are to be covered: anatomy and physiology of the reproductive system, the menstrual cycle, STDs and their prevention, contraceptives and birth control methods, misconceptions regarding sexual intercourse and pornography, teenage pregnancy and unsafe abortions, behavioral changes which includes aggressiveness, mood swings, attraction towards the opposite gender, addiction, peer pressure, risk-taking behavior, drug abuse, and a healthy communication with parents. The legal aspect consisting of sexual crimes, laws and their respective punishments, the safety measures, and the helplines.
Let us look at the schedule of the program. We suggest that these lectures be conducted in every school, once a month, followed by interactive session. There should also be special sessions in this regard by medical professions, twice a year in every school. The session should be conducted by teachers who undergo voluntary training, by doctors and psychologists organized by the Government of India.
For those adolescents who are not enrolled in schools, NGOs, pamphlets and mass programs can be of great help.
Coming to our second component, that is parents. Parents play role must be properly educated on the subject and be assigned topics to discuss with their wards as per their age group.
First, for parents of children below 10 years,
child should be explained about good touch and bad touch,
limited use of social media by both children and parents,
effective communication, at least 15 to 20 minutes with your child every day,
notice for any change in behavior or body language of your child.
Secondly, for the parents of children above 10 years,
parents should talk about physical, mental and psychological changes during puberty,
menstrual changes and hygiene,
nutrition during teenage,
should not encourage gender bias,
pros and cons of attraction towards opposite gender,
body image perception,
effective communication with their wards, means of imparting the above format among parents,
parent-teacher meetings in schools,
immunization visits,
NGOs, doctors and government paid employees,
mass gatherings like panchayat samiti meetings.
Lastly, distribution of pamphlets in the form of advertisement and government advertisements can be of great help.
This whole program would be successful only when there is no hesitancy between the teachers, parents, doctors as well as the adolescents.
All the sessions should be adequate, interactive and two-way.
Sex education should be treated like any other subject and not just a taboo.
We also met and interviewed Padmashree Dr. Prakash Kothari, an eminent sexologist, to aid us with his experience and foresight.
Sex education does not mean teaching people to know what they do not know, but it means teaching them to behave as they do not behave. If proper sex education is given, you can control this, both the problems, by proper sex education. There is HIV/AIDS control as well as population explosion. Or to whom it should be given? Best would be adolescents, because they have got maximum hormones at that time. So as a result, there is maximum sexual desire. So maximum chances of sexual interactions, which can lead to unwanted pregnancies, sexually transmitted diseases, HIV/AIDS, etc. And well, why adolescents? Well, adolescents constitutes 1/3 of the population. So you are educating 1/3 of the current population and 100% of the future population. Sex education is very, very vital, very, very important, and can be best given by parents or those who are well educated, and best by the television.
Change is a challenge.
Change is a fear.
change is a process.
Change is a battle.
Change is the way of life.
Change is to know the real self.
Change is not a need, but a responsibility.
All the members of Team B upon stage. I request them to introduce themselves in the order of the speakers.
Sorin Shah from 5th semester.
Zubi Sheikh, 5th semester.
I'm Harshika Naik from 5th semester.
Shubhra Shukla, 5th semester.
Sankalp Soni, 5th semester.
Priyanka Shinde, 5th semester.
I request the judges to start with the answer round.
I would like to know why you have chosen the way of online survey for this topic.
Thank you for the question, ma'am. Actually, we had conducted a survey at both the levels by the teachers as well in schools as well as an online survey to realize the myths and to expose the realities which are present regarding sex education, because it is still considered a taboo topic in our community, and nearly 41.6% of our respondents have proved that they feel frustrated or they do not know about what actually it is. So we thought it would be the best way to offer a larger audience. All the masses would be included, not only just medicos, paramedicos, non-medicos as well.
So thank which you. Type of study is this?
Ma'am, it's a mixed study. And it has snowball sampling, means we have forwarded the messages and such people would forward the messages to their acquaintances.
One very nice thing is that you have included a module about how to implement sex education.
Yes, ma'am.
But one thing that I noticed was two things, like sexual orientation and intersex. These are two things with which the adolescents become very curious. Okay, so these things, have you dealt with these things in your module? Because I don't think I came across.
Ma'am, we had thought about it as well, but currently there are still some issues with the judiciary also taking up the issue whether Section 377 IPC should be criminalized or not. Many people are still confused about it. As in our medical curriculum as well, we are not taught differently about intersex or persons who identify themselves with different sexuality. So currently we haven't included in it, but we have liberal views towards it.
So it is only because of the legal problems that are involved
currently,
that you
yes,
stayed
ma'am.
Away from it.
Yes, ma'am.
What should be appropriate age to start a sex education, child?
So sex education will start from a very young age, as we have mentioned about good touch and bad touch. It starts from the parents, afterwards it starts in the schools. Also, it's going on throughout the life, because there's concepts like family planning also coming in after we get married. So it should start from the very young age. The parents should actually first of all increase the conversation with the child, as we had mentioned that a talk of 15 to 20 one day is very important, because that will reduce that conversation gap. And if the child is coming across any issues, that the child will go to the parents and not to the peers. So it should start from a very young age. Then, as we had mentioned, it can go for 11 to 13 years. We can mention some parts, and 13 to 15. Generally, if want to mention, like if we give sex education, it is better that we give it in schools, because afterwards, when people go to universities, it is very difficult to access people, because people choose different branches. So it would be very nice if it started school at a very young age, including topics like gender bias and good touch and bad touch, and going to schools where all the physical changes and most importantly the mental aspect of all the changes should be taught to them.
Considering the excess of pornographical content by child, what measure should be taken by parents or people from the family to prevent this?
I think, sir, it's very important that not only child but also parents should try to decrease the access to social media, because if the access to social media is increased, that will increase the exposure of the child to the explicit content on internet. So if the parent itself encourages the child to go for some other activities, which is going to reduce the access to social media, it will surely reduce the access to the explicit content present on internet.
Just to add on, sir, as we all know that these sites are generally accessed by those who do not have a proper education or there are some communication gaps with their parents. So discussing issues with parents in an open way is the key forward, with their parents or their teachers or those whom they consider as guides. Because these sites will always give some negative images or perceptions, whereas a structured curriculum, which is our motto and our aim, will provide the right amount of education for the right period of time.
So I would like to add something. We should we can't restrict the access. So we should create such an environment, the stakeholders should create such an environment that the children themselves should be comfortably able to talk to their parents or their teachers. So that would, like, they won't go to other wrong path.
Even I would like to add something. Even if you can't restrict their access to such resources, what we can do is we can teach them what is the right thing or the right way, so that even if they gain access and view such content, they know that whatever is showed is either fictionalized or exaggerated and should not be actually adopted in their real life. I would also like to add to one more answer of my colleague to the first question, why we chose online survey, online method for survey, because online method has a wider reach and it is easier to reach the people, both with respect to time as well as the economical aspect.
Okay.
Thank you.